Hi, in today's video, I'm going to show you how to service a NuTone chime bass. This is a 4 or 8 note long tube chime bass. This particular one is from around 1988. What a lot of people don't know or remember anymore is NuTone started off as a door chime company. The company was founded by a man named Ralph Corbett, and he founded the company in the mid-1930s. And his original products were NuTone door chimes. And they made a wide variety of door chimes over the years. They still make door chimes today. Unfortunately, the models that they make today don't bear a lot of resemblance to the fine quality of door chimes they've made in the past. So this particular one was sent in by a customer and it no longer operates. And I'm going to show you how to service it, what goes wrong with it, and how to get it working again. So here we have an array of the things that you're going to need to have on hand to do this work. You need a rag. You need some little containers of some sort to hold small parts. I have a couple different kinds of cleaning cloths. This one is a textured cloth. This is a polyester one. I like these a lot. You need some type of cleaning swabs. These are dual-ended on wooden sticks, which I like. Or if you don't have these, you can use Q-tips. That works fine also. You'll, of course, need some screwdrivers, a Phillips, and a small standard screwdriver. You'll definitely need a pencil with an eraser on the end. You may need a pair of scissors and some very fine sandpaper. We won't know that until we get into the repair. And one of the most essential things is you need some lighter fluid. This type of lighter fluid is the type that you would put in a, like say, Zippo lighter, the kind of lighter that your dad had. You need lighter fluid. It's not barbecue lighter fluid, and you definitely do not want to use, let me run the list, no paint thinner, no mineral spirits, no lacquer thinner, no acetone, and definitely no WD-40. You need real light liquid lighter fluid. This is liquid in here, and that's what you have to do this. So let me move all this stuff out of the way and show you what happens to these and how you service them. So let's take a quick look at the chime base first before we start to take things apart. So what it's made up of is there's a metal chassis, and attached to the metal chassis here in the back is essentially it's a circuit board. It's a piece of fiberglass board, and it has silver traces that are attached to the surface of the board. This is not any different than a circuit board you would have in your smartphone or a computer. Even though it's large traces and large screws, it's still essentially a circuit board. Here we have a clock motor. This is a Telechron motor. I have a video in one of our playlists that shows about Telechron motors. These were originally made by General Electric, and yes, they do go all the way back to the 30s. And underneath, this is mounted on this black plastic base. And there are contact arms underneath it, which you'll see. There are two wires that come over and they plug into little sockets onto the circuit board. There's a selector switch here, the red part, where you can select it to ring either 8 notes or 4 notes. Here we have an array of light bulbs that light up the decorative cover of the chime. And then down here, we have the 4 solenoids. There's 1 solenoid for each tube. The tubes hang on these little serrated hangers here. And the tubes, the longest tube is always on the left, and then they become progressively shorter as you go across, giving you that staggered look along the bottom of the tubes that everyone likes so much. The solenoids down here are essentially an electromagnet. Inside the silver box, there's a coil, and if you remember your elementary or middle school science projects when people made electromagnets, an electromagnet is very simple, a length of wire that's very fine, and it's wrapped around and around and around and around a metal core. The brass tube is the metal core, and when you apply electricity to the coil, it makes a magnetic field. Inside the center of the brass tube is the plunger. And when the solenoid or the electromagnet is energized, it causes the plunger to pop out. And on the end of it, on the tip, there's a plastic piece that hits the tube, and that's what makes the sound. So it's a fairly simple design. It's the same type of design that NuTone made for probably 60 years. So it changed in the detail somewhat. The fundamental design is all the same. And to show you that that's the case, let me get something to compare it with. So here we have another NuTone chime base. This is a three-tube chime base. That's why you have three tube hangers here. However, this is very different than the one you just saw. One of the primary reasons that it's different is that this chime base was made in 1939. This is one of the original NuTone long tube chime bases. Although it's very much older than the other one that you just saw, essentially it's the same design. You still have three, in this case, three solenoids, but solenoids nevertheless. However, how it operates is somewhat different. Let me go ahead and open it up and show you inside. It's a completely different type of design. Here we have a solenoid. There is no clock motor in this. This is a mechanical, more of a mechanical chime. When someone would push the doorbell button, it energizes this solenoid and it causes this arm to raise up. And then once you release the push button, the weight of the arm slowly drops and it makes connections on these three points, and that's what makes the tubes ring in the proper order. If I turn this around, you might be able to see in here, this is a clockwork mechanism. These are gears that drive the chime, very much like the gears you would have in an old clock. And this is the way NuTone designed long tube chimes in the late 1930s. If we look inside the cover, you can see the three solenoids. So that gives you an idea that things, the details may change, but fundamentally the design is the same. All right, back to our 1988 version of a long tube chime base. So the things that go wrong with these over time are primarily wear and tear issues. There'll be some servicing that needs to happen underneath the motor base, and then also the solenoids need to be serviced. Right now, these solenoids are pretty well frozen in place. One of the ways you can quickly tell how well these operate is if you just shake it like this, the plungers should move freely inside the brass tubes, and these don't. They're all stuck in place, and that's most likely why this doesn't work. I'm not even going to power this up. I believe the customer when he tells me it doesn't work, and just by shaking it, I can tell the plungers aren't going anywhere. So the first thing we have to do is partially disassemble this. Now, when it comes to disassembly, this is a word of caution. Other than the light bulbs, which are commonly available, these are just standard miniature lamps. These NuTone chimes use lamp number 259, which you can buy in a lot of places. We have them also. Other than buying replacement miniature lamps, there are absolutely and positively no parts available for this new any longer. So if you attempt this type of repair, you must proceed with the absolute care and caution that something like this deserves. If you break a piece, or if you lose a piece, and losing a piece of it while you take it apart is more likely than breaking a piece, you are out of luck. If you lose a spring, or you lose a plunger, or break the tip off of a plunger, or do something else like that, you're not going to be able to find one to fix it. You're going to end up having to buy a used chime base, which is a pretty expensive thing in today's world, and scavenger parts off of it. So if you do this, you must proceed carefully. It's not the kind of thing that you can just willy-nilly work on it, and then if you drop something, you just call up your local NuTone guy and order a plunger for it because he doesn't have them anymore. So let me go ahead and show you how to take some of this apart. We're going to take this apart in steps, because that's the best way I think to do it. All right, so we have it propped up here so you can see it. And the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna remove the motor assembly from the circuit board. Now, in the later models like this one, the wires that come off the motor, have little connectors on the end and we can unplug them. If you have a much older chime base, say one that was made in the 70s or 60s, these wires may be soldered, and in that case it's a little more awkward because you really should desolder them to take the wires out. If you can't do that, you'll just have to sort of manage it as a connected part. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to unplug these connectors. And as a point of interest, when you go to plug these back on, you can see how the wires are sort of curved to the right points here and the upper one, because that's the way they've been for the last almost 30 years. It doesn't, if you were to mix these up and connect them the other way, it doesn't make any difference in how the chime operates. But it's always better, in my opinion, to put things back just as they were than to start changing things around all the time. One of the things that you can do if you're going to do this type of service yourself is use your smartphone and take pictures of things before you take them apart. I tell people that all the time. Most of them don't really do that, and then they call me up and they say, "Oh, I don't remember how it went." Well, take a picture of it or make a drawing. You know, before we all had smartphones, I used to make drawings all the time of how things went so I could remember how to put them back together. So once you've taken the wires out, there are four screws that hold the motor to the circuit board, and we're going to loosen these. Those are pretty tight. And this is where our little containers come in handy. We're gonna put it in the container. You probably heard that. That's one. Two. Three. Sorry, all you can see is my arm. And there's almost four. So you heard all four of them go in the container, right? All right, with the screws out and the wires unplugged, the motor simply lifts off the base. And if we turn it over, see, it's one assembly motor. If we turn it over, you can see on the back of the motor, there's the armature. It's three arms. This is plastic, just like the base. Three arms. And on the end of each arm are copper metal contacts with two contacts per arm. For right now, we're going to set this aside and we're going to look at the circuit board first. So now we're looking at the circuit board, and this is the area where the motor covered it up. And you can see here, first we'll look at the silver traces. So here's a trace, and here's a trace, and there's all sorts. There's a big one right here. It's connected over to here. There's another one. There's all kinds of traces underneath the area where the motor spins the armature. As the motor spins, the contacts on the end of the armature arms touch different traces on the circuit board. Part of that is to apply power to the motor so it runs through its entire cycle before it stops again. And also, the contacts on the end of the armature arms make different connections between different paths on the circuit board, and that's what makes the solenoids ring in the correct order. Oh, wait, look what fell out. Here's the little 4-8 switch, and it fell out of the base when I took it off. I didn't even see it until right then. And there's also contacts on the back of that to make a connection between the 4 and 8 note traces on the board. Again, remember I told you about not losing things? Here's something that if you lose, it won't work at all. So that goes in the cup so we don't lose it. So what happens over 30 years of the armature turning around and around and around every time the motor is activated, and the contacts on the end of the armature arms make and break connections on the different paths. And what you have to think about is there's a small amount of electricity in all of these paths. And as the contacts on the end of the armature arms turn around, it's making connections and then breaking connections and changing where the electricity is flowing. So these black circles you see here, one on the outside and one on the inside, this is carbon. And the carbon buildup is caused by the small amount of sparking that happens when the contacts make and break connections. Carbon is not a particularly good conductor. It's a better insulator in this type of application, and this can prevent the chime from working properly. It can cause the chime, if it loses a connection, it can cause the motor to stall. So when you push it, it begins to rotate. If it loses a connection at the round point, it will not have any electricity and it'll stop, and it won't continue through its cycle. So this needs to be cleaned off. So this is the right way to do this. Here's what you need. You need a pencil, and we don't really care about the pencil part, we care about the eraser. Oh, there it is. See how the eraser already has black on it? Guess where that came from? That came from cleaning off carbon tracks on chime circuit boards. There's a lot of different ideas about how to do this. This is the way that we were taught to do this when I signed up to be a NuTone service center. What do? You clean it with a pencil eraser. People have all their own ideas, and a lot of them are way over the top, and I don't really necessarily agree with a lot of them. You don't need to use chemicals. You don't need to use sandpaper. You don't need to get all exotic about it. All you really need is a pencil eraser. You also have to consider my warning at the beginning of the video. Everything you have to do, you have to be careful and cautious about, because if you ruin this, you will not be able to replace it. So do it the right way. Get a pencil eraser. It's very simple. All you do is you take the pencil eraser and try to do it so you can see it, and you very carefully erase the carbon tracks. All right. So, how long did that take me? What was that, about 15 or 20 seconds? And that's with me standing off to the side with the thing, with the base tilted up so you can see it as I do it. Not the most optimal position to do something like this in. So if I lay it down on the workbench to clean it where I can do it at a better angle, the whole thing will probably take me less than 2 minutes. So get a pencil eraser, clean the carbon tracks, and then you're done. Now I'm going to lay it down and clean the rest of them and then show you what it looks like when it's finished. Okay, I'm back. So I kept track. It took me exactly 2.5 minutes to clean the carbon tracks off the base. So you can see here now, they're almost all gone. There's a little bit of marks left on the fiberglass part, but the silver traces are all clean, and that won't be a problem anymore. Another thing which I should point out on this base is this right here. This is a little metal tab, which you can probably see move up and down. Let me get on the other side. Right here. All right, so this metal tab is connected to a screw under the tape, and it's resting against this post right here. This metal tab is what makes the motor stop spinning. So the motor begins and it spins in this direction. It spins counterclockwise. And as it comes along and it gets up here, one of the arms on the armature has a little tab on it. And when it reaches this point, the tab on the armature arm lifts the metal tab off the post, breaking the connection. That's how the chime knows where to stop. If this little metal piece is gone, or if it breaks off, which does happen sometimes, the chime will run continuously. It will never ever stop because it doesn't know to stop. So this little metal piece you have to be really careful of because it's very thin, and right down here, I can show you, we lift the tape off. Here's the metal piece. It's folded right here, and the other part of it is mounted underneath this screw. This is right here in the fold is where it typically will become weak and break off. If it's cracked, if you clean the metal carefully, it can be soldered back together and that will work just fine. If this is gone altogether, then you have a problem because the chime won't stop. So again, you have to proceed cautiously because if you break this off or you lose it, you've got a real problem. Finding one of these is almost impossible. So again, proceed cautiously. Now let's look at the motor and the armature itself. So here's our motor assembly. And you have the plastic base with the motor mounted on top of it. As I said in the first part of the video, this is a Telechron motor. And what you have here is a coil for the electricity. You have the armature, which are the metal pieces on either side. And then down in here is the motor assembly, the actual motor. This is the Telechron motor assembly. The electric motor part is the small part right here. And down inside the larger base part is the gear drive. This is considered to be a sealed unit. The average person, even here at our shop, we can't disassemble a Telechron motor assembly. It was not designed to be disassembled. There are a couple specialists in the country that I'm aware of that can rebuild them. Generally speaking, that's on much older ones, ones made in the 30s and 40s. For the most part, these are trouble-free. I don't think I've ever had to replace the motor on a long tube chime base as far back as I can recall into the ones I worked on in the 1950s. So generally speaking, leave this alone. Don't mess with it. It'll be fine. If we turn it over and look at the other side, here we have the armature with the three arms and the little copper contacts at the end of each arm. Like the circuit board on the base, sometimes you'll get a little bit of carbon buildup on the copper tabs on the end of the contacts. This one in particular doesn't look very bad at all, so I'm going to leave it well enough alone. One of the things you have to be careful of, if you do have carbon buildup on here, you should, just like you did on the circuit board, clean this with a pencil eraser. However, you have to be very, very careful. If you bend these or break these off, the chime won't work. So if you're going to try to clean them, you have to do something sort of like this. You can put your finger see how it wants to turn? Watch. And see how it glides to a stop? That's because you're turning the gear drive that's inside the Telechron motor. Anyway, so if you support it carefully with your finger, you can use your pencil eraser to carefully clean away the carbon buildup, and it also cleans the surface of the copper. And if you do it really carefully, you might be able to see that this one is now shinier than this one because we've cleaned away the oxidation on here. If it's not real bad, usually it's best just to leave well enough alone. So that's really all you have to do with the motor. The majority of the work we're going to do is actually going to be on the plungers and the solenoids, and that's what we're going to do next. All right, so now we're going to move on to the solenoids, which are these four devices. So we're going to go ahead and turn this over. And on the back of each solenoid, there's a yellow cap. The yellow caps were used primarily starting in the late 70s through the early 2000s. Before that, they were usually black, and inside each one of these will be the identical parts. There'll be the cap, which I'm going to take off. There's usually some type of piece of foam in the back, which just sort of fell in. And this is the piece of foam, or at least what's left of it. This is a cushion that when the spring, after the solenoid is de-energized, there's a spring and it pushes the plunger back into the solenoid and it bounces against the cushion. I'm not sure why that's important exactly, but they've always had them. On the much older chimes, the ones made in the 60s and 50s, instead of being some sort of foam like this, which I assume is a synthetic material, they were rubber cushions. And the rubber cushions tend to disintegrate and turn into this black gooey stuff that gets all over the inside of everything. And that's all very bad. So then what you do is we need to get the plunger out. So we take a small screwdriver, insert it into the front, and push it out. This one came out pretty easily. And then inside here, the last piece is the spring. And the spring, the easiest way to get the spring out is to just tip it over and it falls out. This is the most lost piece on a chime service. If this bounces off your workbench and ends up somewhere on your garage floor, you may never find it. And you might think, oh, it's just a spring, I can get that anywhere. Wrong. Impossible to find an exact replacement for this. These were made for this, so don't lose it. Again, this is where the little cup comes in handy. We're going to put the spring, the plunger, the cap. I don't care about the foam piece so much because there's nothing left of it, but we'll put that in there for now also. So we'll go ahead and disassemble the other four. Caps come off. A little bit of foam cushion. Plungers come out. That one was pretty stuck. And that one was pretty stuck also. All right, the plungers are all out in the little cup. Now we need the springs. And there we have, oh, you can't see it. There we have our three other springs. All of those go in the little cup. And we'll put that off to the side for a second. Okay, so let's talk about what happens to the solenoids and the plungers that prevent the chime from working. You saw when we took it apart that there was a little foam cushion at the end of the solenoid bore. And here we have a plunger. You can see that there's a little piece of foam still stuck to the metal. So what happens is the foam cushion disintegrates into really small particles. And also, doorbells are in people's houses. And sometimes the air in people's houses is not particularly clean, especially after 30 years. You have small particles from cooking, from frying. Back in the day, a lot of people still smoke cigarettes, and you have cigarette smoke, and all kinds of airborne contaminants build up and get inside the solenoid bores. And it builds up on the plungers, and it prevents them from sliding freely. These little electromagnetic solenoids are not super, super strong. They were designed to be strong enough to shoot out the plunger assembly and hit the doorbell tube properly so it sounded the way the engineer wanted it to sound. It doesn't take much resistance to slow it down or to freeze it up completely, so the solenoid is not strong enough to push the plunger out properly anymore. The way you judge this is, if you take a plunger and we're going to slide it into the solenoid, I'm going to slide it in backwards because it's easier to do it that way. If you put it here in the opening and you let it go, it should simply fall down inside. And this one doesn't. It's very rough. See, after we got past the end here where most of the buildup is, then it slid in pretty freely. But if we turn it over, it doesn't really want to slide all the way out. That's as far out as it slid on its own weight. So what we need to do is we need to clean up the insides of the brass bores and we need to clean up the plungers. And that's what we're going to do next. All right, so here are our solenoid parts. We have four plungers. We have four solenoid caps, we have four springs, and we have the remnants of two of the foam cushions. As an interesting point, if you look inside this cap, you can see, wait, we'll look at this one first. So this one is all yellow inside. This one, the foam cushion, is stuck inside the cap. And this is what happens. It's just kind of disintegrated in there and it all falls out in pieces. And that's not necessarily what it's supposed to be. So what do we do with all this? Well, this is where your little cups and your lighter fluid comes into play. The first thing I like to do is take the four springs, put them in the cup, and put a little lighter fluid on them. This will help clean off and dissolve any buildup on the springs. And we're just going to take that and we're going to put it off on the side and they can just sit there for a while we do other things. The foam cushions, I don't care about. We're going to throw those away. The caps aren't too bad, but we're going to put them in a container also and give them a little lighter fluid, because we're going to clean out any foam residue that's inside the caps, so those can sit for a while also. And now we're on to the important part, which are the actual plungers themselves. So the plungers are a chromed steel rod with a plastic tip on the end. Do not break off the plastic tip. This is pressed into the metal. If you break it off, it's really hard to get the remnants out. And then you have to do something like this, which is buy a piece of fiberglass rod like this, and then you have to cut it, and you have to sand it to fit, and then you have to insert it into the metal rod, and then you have to sculpt the end of it so it actually makes a tip, and it's a lot of work. So don't break it off. That's the moral. Okay, so the easiest way to clean these is just like everything else. We're going to put them in a metal cup and we're going to put some lighter fluid on them. Lighter fluid is what was recommended by NuTone to clean chime parts with. And in fact, it might even say right here, let's see what it says. Service instruction: plungers must operate freely. You can clean chime plungers and sleeves as follows. Remove tone bars, no tone bars on this one. Clean plungers with a non-flammable cleaning fluid. Now that's no good. It doesn't say lighter fluid. It used to always say lighter fluid. Maybe this is the new 1988 safety version. Never mind what this says. Use lighter fluid. And see here it says do not oil plungers. That means this: no oil, no silicon, no silicon powder, no grease, no WD-40, no nothing, only lighter fluid. That's the only thing that you put in these is lighter fluid, because it evaporates and it leaves a very, very, very thin film of oil in there, which is all you need for it to work properly. I like the old school way, use lighter fluid. All right, so once the plungers have been in the lighter fluid for a little while, we're going to take our cleaning towel, and all you have to do is clean them off. I like these because they have sort of a high and low surface thing going on with them, and they clean well. Now, this chime is not particularly bad. I have had chimes that I've taken apart that, for all you can do, you can't get the plungers out of the bores. They just don't want to come out. They have so much buildup, especially on the really early ones where the cushions were made out of rubber. They just get stuck in there. And in those cases, since you don't want to damage anything, what you do is you put lighter fluid and you fill them up. You sit it on a rag like this and you fill up the bores from the top. And you let them sit and sit and sit and sit until it starts to dissolve things up. And eventually, if you wait long enough, you'll be good to go. That one's good. See, now this one, it has foam stuck to the bottom. But all we have to do, since we've put lighter fluid on it, if we go like this, it's gone. It dissolves it. It comes off. It cleans the surface of the metal nicely. and it leaves a very thin film of oil or whatever the petroleum product is that they make lighter fluid out of on the surface of it. And those are done. Now we have four clean plungers. We're in good shape. Not wanting to waste the lighter fluid, we'll pour it in here with the springs. I'm always do the springs last. All right, so now we're gonna do the caps. The caps are easy. Just wipe off the outside. We're gonna use our cotton swabby thing here. And we're gonna sort of clean out the insides a little bit. We'll put a little bit more lighter fluid on the cotton swab. Two, three. I don't know why these always break. They always break off. Four. All right. Put that in there. We'll make a little bit of an attempt to dry these off. And that's good. So now we have clean plungers and clean caps. The last thing we have to do are the springs. So we're going to very carefully lift our springs out of the lighter fluid. And you can see how they get all wound together. So we have to very carefully get them separated, and you have to do this without stretching them or making them damaged in any way. They basically sort of coil around each other, and it's kind of a tricky thing to do. Usually if you hold one, you can unwind the second one from it. It's not any easier to do when you're wearing gloves. So there we have our four springs. The only thing we do with these after they've been in the lighter fluid is I put them on the towel and I compress them like this to take off any residue. I do it once because unless they're really, really, really bad, that's all you have to do. And that's it. So now our internal parts are all clean. Now we're going to clean the solenoid bores. All right, so we're looking at the back of our chime base. We're going to do this through the back of the solenoid bores. And what we want to do is clean out any residue or ridges of residue that are built up inside of it that prevent the plungers from dropping in freely. So how we're going to do this is just like we've done everything else. We're going to take our lighter fluid. We're going to do these one at a time. You put a little lighter fluid in the bore. You take your cotton swab. You put a little lighter fluid on that. And you very carefully clean the inside. Most of the residue, the stuff that's down inside the bore, you can see how far down this is in there. It's that far. Most of the residue that's way down inside is pretty light. It's the stuff up here around at the back where the foam cushion was that's the biggest problem. So that one actually is pretty clean. That isn't too bad at all. And the way you judge this is you take one of your cleaned plungers, you sit it in here upside down, and when you let it go, it should go thunk and fall down inside. It should not hang up. You should not have to press it in to make it fall in. It should just go in on its own. Now, while that one seemed pretty good, it wasn't quite as good as I like. So we're going to do one further step on these to do a really good job, and that's where your pencil comes in. But this time we're not going to use the eraser. We're going to use the other end of it. It's also where our piece of sandpaper comes in. So this is a very fine grit. This is a 1,000 grit sandpaper. It's a wet dry sandpaper. You must have something that's at least 1,000 grit for this to work properly. And what we're going to do is we're going to cut a small piece of it. That's where the scissors come in handy. And we're going to take this and we're going to wrap it around our pencil, because it turns out that if you do this right, the sandpaper and the pencil together fit inside the bore really nicely. It's like the perfect size to do this, and you can hone it. I'm going to make that a little bit wider. And I'm going to wrap it this way. Now, if you spin it around it too many times, it'll become too large and it won't fit. So let's see how we did here. No, not quite good enough. All right, so that's good. See how well that fits in there? It's like the perfect size, the pencil with the fine wet dry sandpaper. And all we're going to do is we're going to turn it like this. And you can insert it further down and then pull it back out. You can, I'm not a big fan of going back and forth too much, because it's more difficult to do. The sandpaper gets all bent up inside the bore and then it doesn't work very well. But if you just turn it lightly, when you take it out, you can see all of this light material here. That's fine pieces of brass. And if you could see down in the bore as well as I can, you can see that down in here it's all shiny, because this is solid brass. So it's all shiny here compared to these three, which are dark or black inside from the residue buildup and the oxidation. Then we'll put a little more lighter fluid, and then we'll clean it one more time. And look how much came out. All right, so now we're back to words of caution again. This is a tried and true way of doing this. This works really, really well. Don't go over the top. Don't get out your cordless drill and some kind of honing wheel or a honing tool, or put it on a mandrel and think you're going to do it on a drill press and all those kind of things, because all you're going to do is wreck it. This is a tried and true method. This is one of those jobs that you do by hand, you do it carefully, and when you get done, the end result should be very good. So don't go over the top. Just do it like I say. So we'll take our plunger, we'll put it back in the bore upside down, and we'll drop it. And look how it fell in. It just went thunk and disappeared just like it's supposed to. So that's one. Now I'm going to do the other three. I'm going to do those off camera, because this is a customer's chime and I have to do it properly, and it's hard to do it standing off to the side. So once I get them all cleaned, then I'll show you how to put them all back together. Okay, so I've cleaned all of the bores. I did it just like I did the first one. I cleaned it with the lighter fluid and a swab first. Then I honed it with the 1,000 grit sandpaper. Then I re-cleaned it with more lighter fluid and a clean swab. And all of them are clean and shiny, and the plungers all drop down inside very nicely. So now it's time to reassemble the bores, which is pretty straightforward. The first thing you do is you take a spring and you put a spring in the bore. Then you take the plunger and you put it tip in first, and you can see how it just slides down inside. It actually hit the spring and you can see the tip pop out, and then it bounced out. So we'll do the second one. And the third one. And last but not least, the fourth one. and those all slide really well. The other thing that I made was new foam cushions. All I did was take a small piece of closed cell. This is like insulating foam that you can buy at the hardware store. And I used a paper punch of the right diameter and punched out kind of little circles. These are not super critical. And what I like to do is put it in the cap first, and then if it doesn't fall out, you put the cap back on. So there's one. Two. Three. Four. Now our plungers are all put back together, or our solenoids are all put back together. So here's our almost completely reassembled chime base. And if you remember in the first part of the video, I showed you how you can check the plungers by shaking the base. And when I did that, they didn't move. Now when I shake the base, you may not be able to hear that, but I can. I can hear the plungers sliding, or the plungers sliding back and forth inside the solenoids, so now they're not stuck anymore. So all we have left to do is put the motor back on, and we're going to be all set to try it out. Okay, when it comes time to put the motor back on, there's a couple things to do. Remember, we found the wayward 4-8 switch with the red tip on it that fell down here when we took the motor out. This has to go back in the motor base. And it fits in here, this little slot. You just put it through like this. And you kind of have to hold it with your finger when you turn this over, otherwise it's going to fall out again. Another thing to be aware of is, in the center of the armature, there's a little pin. And this little pin fits in this little hole. And that's what keeps it from flopping around when it turns. So when you go to set the motor in place, you have to make sure you get the pin lined up with the hole. Otherwise, when you tighten it down, you could break this. And we've already talked a lot about what happens when you break any part of this, so we won't talk about that again. So we'll go ahead and set this down in place. And then we'll take our screws that have been in their little container and get two of the screws back in first. Alright, so now our motor is back in place. Our 4 and 8 switch slides freely. And now we're going to reconnect the two wires. Remember, we talked about how they have sort of permanently curved. So we know based on that that this one goes here and this one goes here. Alright, now our chime base has been serviced, it's been reassembled. Now it's time to hook it up and see how it works. Okay, so I have the chime base. We reassembled the chime base. I have it sitting up on some containers so you can see it better. I have it connected up to power, which is on right now, and you can see the four lamps are lit. The original lamps were, one of them at least, were burnt out, so they, when I powered it up the very first time, they didn't come on. One of the things you have to know about these lights are, these are wired in series, which means the electricity comes in on a wire here, goes through this one, and then through this one, and then through this one, then through this one, and then back to the board on this side. These are like the old Christmas tree lights that we had when I was a kid, where if one bulb went out, the whole string went out. So there was probably only one bulb that was burnt out, because that's usually the way it goes. But when you're servicing someone's chime base, if they need one bulb, you should just replace all four so you're starting fresh again. They're not that expensive and it's much better to do it all at one time. So let's go ahead and test our chime. This chime has three different rings. You have a front connection here, which is the one that makes it play either four or eight notes. You have a side connection for a side doorbell button, which rings one of the tubes, and the rear button rings another one of the tubes. So it's different notes for rear than side. So let's go ahead and we'll do the rear first. And you can see here, the plunger pops out properly. Then we'll try side, and it rings this one. And now we'll ring front. And that was all eight notes. One of the things about NuTone chimes when they ring eight notes is the order of notes as it goes up the scale. I should do that here. As it goes up the scale and then it comes back down, two of them on the downside are reversed compared to the upside. That's what gives it its unique sound. So we'll ring that again on four notes. And that's it, it's just four notes. So we'll wait till it stops. And if you won't be able to hear it, I can. As it's running, you can hear the gears in the Telechron motor actually turning. So we'll go back to eight notes and ring it one more time. And that's all there is to it. It works really well now. One of the other adjustments on these type of chimes is this right here. This is, they consider it to be a volume adjustment. In fact, there's a little label still on this one. It says volume, loud, or soft. And you can use a screwdriver and turn this. And this is a rheostat. And basically what it's doing is it's adjusting the amount of voltage that the plungers receive when the motor assembly tells them to strike. The less voltage there is, the softer they strike, the lower the sound the tube produces. In most homes, these are always cranked up to the loudest setting, which isn't always necessarily right. So I'm not going to explain how to set up tubes and set up a chime like this in this video, but down in the video description, there will be a link to a page on our website that has the short version of how to set up a musical chime or a long tube chime properly so it rings the very best that it can. There'll also be a link to some information on our website that tells you in more detail how to clean the brass tubes and things like that, because I don't think you watching me clean brass tubes with Brasso would be very interesting. However, this doesn't always have to be at full, but read the page in the link and it'll give you some insight about how to set up your tubes and the volume correctly. That's all for today. I hope you found this interesting and helpful. People really do enjoy their NuTone chimes, particularly their long tube chimes. In the 30 years that I've been doing this, I've learned that people have a lot of sentimental attachment to their door chimes. Oh, and by the way, they're not doorbells, they're door chimes. That's what Mr. Corbett always called them, so that's what we call them here. So if you liked our video, please give it a thumbs up on YouTube. If you would subscribe to our channel, you'll be able to keep track of our newest videos as they come out. That's all for today. See you on the next video.